Hi, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to this next installment of real-time music and sound with Pure Data. In this series, we're exploring synthesis and sequencing, the basics of electronic music using the Pure Data environment. This particular video is focused on graphical user interface objects in PD. Let me start by showing you an example of some of those. This is an interface to a software application called Ripples that I created in PD. And you can see that it uses a number of interface elements. There are a big start and stop toggle button here, some sliders, a bang for starting things, various of them. You can see that they've got different sizes and different colors. So it's somewhat crude, but nevertheless, it does allow us to create controls for all of our audio software in Pure Data. So that's what we're going to look at today. So let's begin. We'll start by recreating a simple oscillator with volume and frequency and amplitude controls, and then we'll look at using some of these graphical user interface objects to control it. So we're going to start with a straightforward oscillator, and I'm going to make it run at 440 Hz. You'll see that we provided an argument to this oscillate object, 440, which provides it with a default frequency. We're then going to provide an amplitude or an amplifier control for this. We'll also give that a default argument of 0.1. It just means that it's going to start at that value and we can override it. The same with the oscillator, starts at 440 Hz, but we'll be able to override that value. We connect those two together, so the oscillator output goes to the multiplier to amplify it, and then we'll send that out to the digital to analog converter so that we can hear it. And there we have it. A sine wave at 440 Hz, reasonably quiet. In order to be able to control these things, what we've done in previous videos is to use a number box and then use that to sort of increase or decrease the values. You'll see that the new values that go in to this case the multiply object override the initial values that are there by default. And we can do a similar thing. We can do a similar thing for frequency. Put a number box up here into the left inlet. And we can hear that that's controlling the frequency. Okay, so that's all good and well. But what we really want to do is to show you how we can use graphical user interface controls for this. So, as with all the other kind of objects that go into PD, we go to the put menu, and we can see that there are a number of these ones, these visual graphical user interface objects here in this section of the put menu. So we're going to start with the vertical slider, the V slider object, and that creates a slider. I can move it around with my mouse, and when I click, it will be sort of fixed in location. I'm going to put it here and reposition the other objects down there and connect it to the frequency. We can then click and drag and it changes the frequency. The frequency is very low, you possibly can't even hear it. We can see on my oscilloscope that it's there, but it's very, very low. The reason for that is that the numbers are only going by default from 0 to 127. So these slider objects do that, that's their default alarm range. It's quite handy if you're doing some work with MIDI, because the MIDI dial and or slider ranges from 0 to 127, but it's not so useful for frequency. So this brings us to an important point around most objects, and in particular these GUI objects. If we right click onto the slider, we'll see that it has a couple of menu options. The help we've seen in earlier videos. Properties though, we're going to have a look at now. So most objects in PD will have a properties view that looks similar to this, and where we can specify various aspects of it. We can see this slider has a width and a height, an output range going from a low value of 0 up to a high value of 127, some various things about its parameters, some messages it can send and receive, and we can provide it with a label. In that case, we might even want to call that frequency. And we can change it so that it has a different color. We might want to make this one blue. Most importantly in these properties for us right now, though, is this range. Instead of it going from 0 up to 127, that's not a very useful range for audio. We might want it instead to, say, have a lower range of 50 hertz and an upper of, for a moment, 2000. It's not super high, but high enough. So I'm going to click on OK. Now, turn that up slightly. Our slider covers that new range from 50 hertz at the lowest all the way up to 2000 hertz at the top. And as you can see, that's much more convenient than being just simply moving the number box and scrolling that, where its range is relatively limited up in these high number things. Okay, so that's all good and well. So we might want to apply a similar process to the amplitude. We can give it also a new V slider. I use the keyboard shortcut then for that. So this one, we'll also have a look at its properties before we connect it. We know this is going to be for amplitude, so I can give it a label. Amplitude ranges usually go from a low of 0 up to a maximum of 1. You have to be very careful here. We don't want the default 127 to go into our amplitude, because a volume of 127 is 127 times the maximum volume that will distort. If you're wearing headphones, that might do damage to hearing, so be very careful. We'll give this a slightly different color just because. Then we can connect that into our amplitude thing, move that out of the way. And there we go. We have a GUI slider for our amplitude. So that's already pretty useful. And you can see how sliders are used all over the place in synthesizers, controllers, and we can use these sliders like that. You might also notice that the sliders also have an input, an inlet at the top. So this means, for example, if we get a number box and put it in there, we can send a value to a slider and it will reflect it here. You also may recognize from previous videos that we know we can get a message box and we can put a number in that message box, connect it, and when we click on the message box, it sends that message or that number. And in this case, just turn it up a little bit so we can change to a different frequency. Each time we click on the number box, it resets our frequency to 1000 hertz. Alright, let's just move that out of the way for the minute. So let's do something a little bit more fun with our frequency. I'm going to introduce the random object. So I click outside and it resolves itself. So the random object does the obvious thing. It selects a random number and its argument is the maximum number. So in this case, it's going to give us a random number between 0 and 2000. I can connect that to the frequency and we can generate for ourselves some random frequencies. At this stage, however, we'll notice we click on this random object, I'm clicking, but nothing is happening. We need to trigger the random object, And this is where we can introduce one of the other GUI objects. From the put menu, one of the other GUI objects is called a bang. We can put this bang there, and a bang basically just sends this sort of special trigger message called a bang. Every time we click on it, you can see that it flashes to show that's happening. If I connect that bang to random and then click on it, generates a random frequency, in this case 1,858 hertz, 1,327 hertz, 214 hertz. So all of these numbers are within this random range. And if we want to have a little bit of fun with the bang, like the other GUI objects, if we go into its properties, it also has a number of things. So I can give it a label. Might just call it trigger. There's various things about its size. I might want to make it a little bit bigger, make it 30 pixels wide. I might want to make a different color, maybe this time orange. Go OK, move it out. You notice that the trigger label is over the top of the box, so I'm just going to go and fix that up a little bit. The location for the label is here. That X offset, I might make that 25 instead. The Y offset can probably be 0. Okay, takes a little bit of working around. Maybe the Y offset needs to be like negative 10, and make that 0. That's more like it. It doesn't change its functionality, but at least you can then see, if we open up this patch in performance, it will be very easy for us to see that these colored GUI objects are the things that we need to interact with during our performance, whilst the other objects are there just simply to execute the audio functions that we want them to have. So there's one more GUI object that I want to introduce to you in this particular video, and that is the toggle object. So here's a toggle object. What happens is when you click on the toggle object, it changes its state. And it has only two states toggling, between on and off, if you like, or between 1 and 0. If we connect a number box to the toggle, we'll see that it generates a 1 when it's on and a 0 when it's off. So that's all good and well. It also has properties. Again, this is size. We can make it large to match the trigger size. We can give it a label. In this case, I might look at making it operate as a mute thing on our amplitude. And I can give it a color. We need to also manage this offset for the label. Call it negative 10. Okay, so there's our mute button. We need to make that function. This is going to kind of be a little tricky, but we'll see how we go. I'm just going to disconnect that. I'm going to move the mute button down here. And what we really want to do is to make it so that when I click on this button to be off, we know it's going to send a 0. And I want that 0 to go to the volume so that we get a 0 volume when it turns off. So we could just simply connect it there, but the problem with that is we're going to get a 0 when it goes off, but we're also going to get a 1 when it goes on, and a 1 is the maximum volume, and that's going to be quite loud, and we don't really want to just suddenly turn it up to maximum volume. So I'm going to use another object which is called select, and I'm going to select that one. So just grab that one so that the one doesn't go past. It's going to look for the one value, and when it gets that, that's going to be fine. But when it doesn't get it, when it gets the 0, the 0 is going to come out here. So the 1 would come send a bang out here, and the zero is going to come out here. Let me just give myself some more space. And so we want that zero when it comes out there to go to our volume. So we can turn our volume up. And then when we, that's on, that's one, and then we click it to turn off. And the zero is selected and it gets passed and we do our mute. So that's all good and well, but at the moment then when we try and turn it on, you'd expect a mute button to turn on, but it doesn't quite do that. So what we're going to do in order to make that happen is take the bang which comes out of here when it is a one, and we're going to bang our amplitude. So we're going to sort of trigger basically that amplitude to turn on, like so. And then the zero is passed here, so it's starting to act like a mute button. So it kind of works. Turn it down, mutes, goes back to the volume that it was at. That's all. This looks like it's operating pretty well. There is one problem, however, and that is that when it's on, it sort of doesn't necessarily keep its state. You see, then it didn't go on, it didn't mute off. So there's one more thing we can do to make this work better. Take that out of there so that whenever we move this, it sends the value to the trigger. So any value other than zero will turn it on. You'll see that when we move that all the way down to zero, it does mute it. So now it's going to behave. Every time we remove this slider, it unmutes, and we can mute it. We can unmute it if we want to, or we can just move the slider to reinitialize things. And so there's a little bit of things work going on here, but you can see what's going on. So we've seen these sliders. We can have them horizontal or vertical. There's a horizontal one, does exactly the same thing, but just in the opposite direction. We've got these vertical sliders. We've got bangs, which can trigger things to happen. And we've got a toggle, which can change state from 0 to 1 or from off to on. So that's kind of an introduction to GUIs in the PD environment. You can now make all of your wonderful audio patches look nice with some colors and operate more easily with these GUI sliders. Set the maximum and minimum ranges so you know you're always going to get something which is just within the range that you want. So go and see how you go with that. Have a play with your GUI new knowledge, and I'll see you in the next video.